Hi, good evening. My name is Laura. I'm with the Museum, Education, and Creative Programs Department at Bethel Woods Center for the Arts. At Bethel Woods, it's our mission to inspire, educate, and empower through the arts and humanities. And I'm here to introduce you to another series in our Bethel Woods at Home programming. We have a curator happy hour this evening, which is going to be a lecture, discussion, and listening session. We'll be talking a lot about movements and music. At times during our session tonight, you will see a small record icon, and that's your cue to crank it. Turn your volume all the way up so you can listen to the music along with us. Bethel Woods at Home is a series of interactive lectures, performances, and workshops that help us explore the historic legacy here at Bethel Woods and the healing power of the arts, creativity, and community. So thank you again for joining us. Don't forget to send your questions and comments and enjoy. So I'll introduce you now to our senior curator here at Bethel Woods, Dr. Neal Hitch. Have a great time.
Well, that was great. Good evening, everyone. It's glad you could join us. I'm glad you could hear me. My name is Dr. Neal Hitch. I am a senior curator at the Museum at Bethel Woods, the historic site of Woodstock. Tonight we are doing our curator happy hour, which is a conversation with a playlist. And tonight we're going to talk a little about music that has an impact, like a large cultural impact. Maybe music is protest, or music is activism, music is activation. Certainly, art, music is a driver of cultural change. That is what we talk about almost daily here at the Museum at Bethel Woods. We're going to have a conversation. I hope that everyone has had an opportunity to look at the playlist, or hopefully today you listen to the playlist. Maybe you have it on in the background right now. But our conversation tonight is with two scholars out of New York City that are really experts in the field of looking at music as protest or music as activation, let's say. We're welcoming tonight Adina Williams, founder and president of Adina Works Productions. Adina advises and partners with arts and cultural sector organizations such as the Brooklyn Arts Incubator, National Sawdust, and artists across disciplines, including Tony Award nominated choreographers, Carol Armitage, Camille Brown, Pulitzer Prize laureate Wynton Marsalis, who is on our playlist tonight, Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Daryl DMC McDaniels of the hip hop group Run DMC, most recently, the late opera legend, Jesse Norman. Adina has had a career creating programming that is unique, mission specific. She holds master's degrees in arts administration and elementary education from Teachers College, Columbia University, and a Bachelor of Arts in Music, playing the violin from Baldwin Wallace University. We're also going to be joined tonight by Dr. DeWeston Haywood, a historian, an author, a sonic scholar, historian of 20th century American history with research and teaching interests in Black protest, protest thought, Black masculinity, Black power, and the intersections of Black culture and Black public spheres. He currently teaches at Hunter College in New York City. One of his classes is King versus Kanye, something that I've talked to him about of real interest. He looks at ideas and generational impact on society, treating these two cultural icons as symbols of the eras they represent, something I think we'll probably touch on tonight. His work also includes forays into an innovative scholarly praxis he calls sonic scholarship. This strategy works to generate new ways to analyze history, test hip hop as an analytical framework and a scholarly methodology. That framework bridges academic and popular discourses, and also something I think that we're really going to talk about. Adina has joined us. Welcome, Adina. It's good to see you tonight.
Great to be here with all of you.
And DeWeston has joined us. Good to see you.
Good to see you both.
So, I mean, we open tonight with A Love Supreme. It's a critically acclaimed jazz album recorded in one take in December 1964. It's considered one of the greatest albums of all time and included as our opener because it came from a previous conversation that the three of us had. And Adina had mentioned this album in particular as kind of fundamental. But also, I think DeWeston had shared a book. I believe this is a book that he teaches in his class, Satchmo Blows Up the World, Jazz Ambassador to the Cold War. It's a book published in 2004. It's about the U.S. State Department program to send jazz musicians around the world during the Cold War. And in a way, as I think about this book and have looked at it, it's really a formal acknowledgement of how much power there is in music to promote cultural conversations and maybe even cultural change. And so I think that kind of started a conversation we're having about the power of music within culture. And it's interesting to me that that starts with jazz. Music that really doesn't have lyrics, but has a power to create a cultural change. So I've included, we've included several jazz songs on this playlist. What do you think about that? You've taught this book, DeWeston. Like, how do you think that begins a conversation about culture, looking at jazz and how jazz has been used?
Right. So if you're really interested in this topic, this is a great book to start you off because it's this instance in which America is embroiled in the Cold War and wants to win a number of wars on a number of fronts. One of those is a war of economies, war of technology that helps bolster the space age. And then there's the cultural war, too. Right. And leading the front lines in this culture war are jazz musicians, many of which are Black. And the idea was the federal government invests in these musicians because jazz was uniquely American. Right. So this music born out of struggles on the part of African Americans, especially in the Deep South, who migrated in the Great Migration up to cities like Chicago and Pittsburgh, New York, and so on, are now find themselves by the 1950s and into the 60s, representatives of the US as official state ambassadors. And so this is a significant point because why choose jazz musicians? Why choose them over, let's say, your typical intellectual or your typical, these are cultural producers. These are musicians who play instruments. How is it that they can convince other nations across the world that they should jump on board with the American program? And so it's significant that the State Department reaches out to jazz musicians to do this. And it really speaks to this point that we'll get into about the power of music to not only change minds, but in this capacity to serve as diplomatic policy. And so this is huge, I think.
Adina, you've worked directly with some of the, well, with jazz musicians, and also your background in music kind of also led to this kind of conversation. I think you had mentioned Miles Davis as someone really important, and I'll make a note here that on the playlist, that's the earliest dated song, So What by Miles Davis, 1959. You listen to that today, it would hold up with anything that's recorded today. And again, these just are setting a tone of what is going to happen in music in a way that, again, on this playlist makes it kind of seamless through some really powerful protest songs, but these also feel like protest songs.
Yes, I would agree. You know, it's so interesting that the U.S. State Department, you know, chose these titans of jazz to kind of win the hearts and minds of what was then called the Third World, right? And even in the midst of all of this, you know, they kind of flipped the script. You know, jazz is what Dr. Billy Taylor always said, you know, America's classical music in many ways. It's homegrown. And Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, Dizzy Gillespie were going to use this now global megaphone they had to kind of tell some tales out of school, and in this case, out of nation. You know, while they were playing this incredible music on stage, they were also, you know, in their own ways, really defiant, speaking out, you know, with proclamations actually in the belly of the, you know, in the concert hall, on the concert stage, and even in the wee hours of the night, you know, collaborating, creating new types of musics, if you will, with former colonized artists from Asia to Africa to the Middle East. And then if you look to Miles Davis, a man who, you know, could have lived comfortably to some extent for an African-American man in his era and in his middle class-ish status at the time, but he decided to speak out and take on the academy, if you will, you know, kind of the beacon of the westernized canon of music, Juilliard. He didn't stay that long, but he was there. And then he went on to, you know, speak out again with the great John Coltrane and you know, Charlie Parker. And then later in life, you know, became kind of the mentor of the Defiant Ones with Chick Corea and Herbie Hancock, and, you know, interweaving between, you know, commercial music, throwing a little Prince and Cyndi Lauper and some synth action on the stage. And, you know, droves of people, including myself, went to the concerts to just witness this, you know, just to hear that sound. It almost didn't matter what style, because it was Miles. And he still breaks boundaries and defies the odds, because we lost him in 1991. But he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2006. So his defiant roar resounds today. Mm-hmm.
And really quickly, I just want to pick up on something Adina mentioned, and it's right to point out, to borrow her own language, of flipping the script. Just how significant that was, that these jazz musicians are carted out by the State Department to these different countries. And the State Department is struggling in many ways to corral them, to rein them in. because they want them to represent the U.S. in specific ways, but true to as music, they're improvising as they go along, and in many ways are may or may not show up for some of those performances and instead enjoy jam sessions with local grassroots musicians. So I'm sure some of what will come out in our conversation tonight, just some of the struggles that some groups or powers that be try to impose on artists and the resistance that those artists put forth so that they're not controlled and their music is maintained, the integrity of it is maintained.
So when we start a conversation about art and the artists, I'm sitting here in my office and I'm sitting at the historic site of the Woodstock Music and Art Fair, a culminating defining moment at the end of the 1960s. We get a question a lot from visitors and others about whether the festival was about protest. And that's a difficult question to answer definitively. But when you look at the oral histories, there's a very consistent thing that runs through that, and that is the people that attended understood the music as the protest. And I think now, I think on, how do we define protest music or the art of protest? Kind of that history here at the Woodstock Festival kind of begins in a way with Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan writes Blowing in the Wind in 1962. It's kind of the first of these protest songs, protesting the war, but it doesn't mention kind of the war directly. It's about a general bigger idea about trying to figure out, I think he's 21 at the time, maybe trying to figure out how you deal with the world. That follows, Sam Cooke writes A Change is Going to Come in 1963. And it's after he's refused a hotel room while he's on tour in the South. And this is a direct reflection of his experience in the civil rights area. What happens is he talks about Bob Dylan writing a song he wishes he wrote. And so he pens this song that again becomes just iconic. Buffalo Springfield. Stephen Stills writes in 1966, For What It's Worth, after witnessing riots in the Sunset Strip. Joan Baez is here on stage. She is talking on stage at Woodstock about her husband being arrested for draft dodging. This is Sam Cooke. We're going to listen to this for a little bit. A lot like jazz, this is kind of this great soul tune that in itself is a great song, but unbelievable message.
Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there. Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
So, in a way, so we use this song. We give these lyrics to docents that interpret Woodstock, interpret this song in our exhibit, and it really sets up a song that sets up what's going to happen in the 1960s. And that is, a forecasting that, man, there's stuff going on, but a change is going to come. And the two of you, how does this, that kind of protest of the 1960s, the art or the music, influence kind of your work? Or how do you see that movement beginning to happen here?
Okay, I thought Adina might want to go first. for me, to go back to your earlier question and sort of to try to combine them, I take my definition of protest music, the cue I take from Nina Simone, actually. And, you know, I think her conception was that protest music, or music in general, really, especially at the point at which she arrived in the 1960s and into the 1970s, motivated, shaped, reflecting the civil rights struggle and Black power. She said that music is supposed to shake up. It's supposed to provoke consciousness. And it's supposed to make people curious. And in many ways, I think music in general, but protest music in particular, serves to provide a storyline, a very compelling one, especially when political discourse may ignore that very compelling story or misinterpret that very compelling story. So in some ways, the music becomes autobiographical for artists who are experiencing the thing they're actually talking about, or reflecting the thing that they're talking about in the music or playing on the chord, right? And I think that, you know, how it influences me in so many ways, one as a scholar, but also as an artist, that it forms the soundtrack to the work I do as a scholar and as an artist, that I'm deeply moved by protest music. I make protest music. And it's explicitly that. So there are artists who may decide not to do that. There are artists who may decide that they're going to provide one song or two on a full album that addresses particular issues, while the other songs may not. And that's perfectly fine, right? So that's what protest music means to me. And I think I try to draw on that deep history of folks like Adina Simone, as Adina mentioned, some of those jazz musicians who use their work and their music to buck the system.
Yes, I mean, when you say the 60s, I would even go to the 1760s, because I also come from the classical world, and even before that. So on a personal level, my days often open with a meditation of Tibetan monks playing longhorns, Beethoven, Dvorak, John Coltrane's Love Supreme, My Favorite Things, Jimi Hendrix national anthem interpretation, anything from Motown, Billie Holiday, Patsy Cline, Loretta Lynn, and Jesse Norman's, you know, impressive sets of repertoire. And as the daughter of activists, with my mother working side by side with the late great Congresswoman Shirley Chisholm, and workshopping with Dr. Bernice Regan, the co-founder of Sweet Honey and the Rock, and Pete Seeger's close creative collaborator, and reflecting a lot on my mom's shuttling proudly musicians and artists and global scholars coming to town for spiritual and musical and artistic enlightenment in the 60s, blues singers, anthropologists turned drummers, rock stars, including a guitarist from Jefferson Airplane, who bounced me on his knee after Woodstock, just days after, on a hot day, I think in August of 1969. The music of the 60s, the 1960s included, just prior and immediately following, has been similarly, DeWeston, the soundtrack or the soundscape of not only my work efforts, but my life. And I would say the rhythms, the mission-driven lyrics the almost tantric energy. When you listen to Jimi Hendrix, it's like tantric, you know. That energy is ever relevant and runs through the core of kind of the, you know, what and the why of what I do. So.
You had mentioned or alluded to this idea of platform and how an artist may have a platform or takes advantage of a platform. And maybe they, you know, I don't know, there's kind of a debate we may talk about later of what the if there's a responsibility or what the responsibility is for someone to do with a platform as they are creating art. One of the songs on the playlist that we're going to listen to in a few minutes here is really kind of pivotal, I think, at this idea of creating something that maybe lives beyond you, becomes a masterpiece of protest. Maybe that's your intention. Maybe that's not his intention. And this is kind of, again, something that DeWeston had brought up before. I'm talking about Marvin Gaye and kind of the development of a power as an artist, because you are producing some great songs and the kind of they're out there. And then you reflect on something and take a minute and say, well, what am I doing here? And DeWeston, you've talked about this in a great story, and I'd like you to do that here.
I think we fall into a trap of putting artists, expecting them to do work we may not be willing to do ourselves, to put it simply. And so there are artists who make a deliberate decision to make message music. And that can come with commercial consequences. There are artists who may start off making commercial music and are suddenly moved by an event, a historic moment, to begin making message music. And that comes with consequences. And then there are artists who decide to simply just make music that entertains, might provide some of the music to a moment in your life, and that's simply it, and that's fine too, but then that also comes with consequences. And so I think there's so many metaphors laden for artists, because it's, you're on stage, right? You're performing, right? And you're being viewed by an audience that may put you under surveillance, even as you're trying to entertain them, right? And your decisions as the artist, what to sing, what not to sing, do you devote an entire album to a particular message, or do you just do one song or no song at all? And I think for Black musicians, this has been a fraught question, because in so many ways, as been mentioned earlier about Sam Cooke, for instance, that he pins A Change Is Gonna Come after being discriminated against in the Deep South. In addition to other artists, as I mentioned, Nina Simone, who is becomes a part of a collective of intellectuals, writers, artists, playwrights, and civil rights activists. And that infuses her music. And so much of the time, I think it's the case that artists are responding to historic moments. But sometimes it's the case too that the audience may not grow with the artist. And we want them to give us what they gave us on the last album. Or we were expecting something new for this new album, and they missed the mark. And so in many ways, I think, again, especially for Black artists, the music exists on a sliding scale of political ideologies, much like we do as human beings. And there are different events in our lives that shape the way we might see something politically, socially, psychologically, so on and so forth. And artists are no exception to that. And so it's hard for, I think, sometimes artists to accommodate the changes that their fans might make, even as the fans think that the artist should accommodate the changes they've made. So it's always this tug of war, I think, between artists when you're really invested in that artist.
So this Marvin Gaye song, What's Going On? One of the things he is, I don't want to hear it yet, but it's written by a member of the Four Tops. I can't remember who, but he experienced, he sees a riot in Berkeley, police brutality in Berkeley while on a tour bus with the Four Tops. And he kind of pins this song. I think the story goes something like he says to somebody, what's going on here? And then, you know, he writes that. And then Marvin Gaye had experienced the Watts riots in 65. And at that time, you know, I think came to Motown and was like, how can I be singing love songs when the world is, you know, going crazy around me? And there's a real pushback on that, right? I think kind of the idea at that point is, how are you going to make money? If you're a company and you have a business, your business is to produce music that is popular and sells. How do you make money doing a protest song? Marvin Gaye being one, I believe one of them, one of the highest selling artists on Motown. And so what happens with that? I think that story that you had talked about to Weston is he goes ahead and he says, look, I'm going to do this song, right? Like this is that important to me. And I think even maybe a fight with.
Okay. Right. So this leads to an internal struggle at Motown between Marvin Gaye and Berry Gordy, who wants to shelve the project. And Marvin Gaye takes a stand. He says that he won't do any more music until the album is released, until the song What's Going On is released. It's finally released in 1971. And so that's the internal stand he took to make sure that music got out. And of course, the resistance came from Motown because Motown had a particular sound. Protest wasn't a part of it, though they had also recorded some activists' talks, panels, and poetry. But this wasn't as elevated, of course, as the music from Hitsville, USA, right? So this is Marvin Gaye taking this deliberate, decidedly political stand because he recognizes the power of his platform. And Motown believed that there would be consequences. And it actually, the reverse happened, that it was one of the best-selling albums then, still is, and it's considered legendary. Today. So again, artists are faced with this critical decision that they have to make as often as any of us as human beings living in the world and living in particular moments in history, that you make a decision or not, and you decide to use your music to protest, to critique, to raise a critical voice or not. And in this case, Marvin Gaye did and gives to us one of the most powerful pieces of music, narrative, and critique, I think, of all time, at least in my opinion.
So right before we listen to it, I want to talk about this. He self-produces this album, and it's almost like a concept album, which, you know, will become huge right after this. And The beginning is a conversation. He brought people into the studio to have this kind of idea that we should be having a conversation about what's going on. And if you listen, there is a power that is just incredible. One of the reasons why the song has stood up across decades is today listed as number 4 on the Rolling Stone 500 greatest songs of all time. And we're going to listen to it right now. Listen to the conversation, how it moves into jazz, and then
brother, brother, there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see, oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on?
Oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
So this song comes in 1971 and really sets a tone for, I think, what protest music will become, and that's really popular music. And it's kind of it will be driven by some of the most popular songs are really about some of the most atrocious activities. And this is going to happen across the world. We're going to get into a group of songs on the playlist that is what Adina kind of brought up and added and thought was important. And what's interesting is we're coming out of Detroit. And, you know, we talked about the Watts riots in Detroit in 65 and then, you know, moving into riots in Chicago in 68. And, you know, what's going on is a reflection of all that's happening. But then we move into the late 70s and 80s. And this kind of idea of how song can carry a cultural message or cultural change will happen across the globe. And so I think this is right in Adina's expertise and kind of what she really thought was important within the playlist and is really important within the conversation. So Adina, please.
Oh, thank you. I'm humbled. Yes. And I just have to say, you know, what an entree, what an opening, a golden pathway for our now new president to slide right into what's going on. You know, it is ever relevant, that masterwork. Yes, but I think with Marvin Gaye's influence and coming from the jazz and classical worlds and the popular worlds, that fellow master artists like Hugh Masekela, you know, on trumpet, writing a poem for the beautiful and powerful Miriam Makeba is so, so very important in this narrative of protest music. So I would be remiss not to have Soweto Blues. And then Neal bested me with, I think, a 2020 version with Jules, the producer who's Ghanaian and British, bringing together South African young female artist and another British DJ and artist, kind of riffing off of those ever timely themes that Mr. Masekela, Ms. Makeba expressed. So I think that global resounding to the world, right, is so very important when we talk about liberation, that America was at the heart of it. We were living through, you know, apartheid and Nelson Mandela, the wonderful composition that Neal chose to kind of pair up with Miriam Makeba and Hugh Masekela is really powerful. Jazz artists like Abby Lincoln and then her wonderful husband, who I had the honor of knowing in my lifetime, the great drummer, Mr. Max Roach, responded also to what was going on in South Africa and across the world. So I think the song selection, you're really going to hear the synergy across the globe sonically. So
this there's a very large movement in the late 80s and 90s, artists against apartheid, where artists take a stand and say, we are not going to play in South Africa, and put kind of, it's a boycott. And there's this is almost opposite of the power a song has, where this is a power that a song, by removing the song, has. And there's a lot of pushback. And I become aware of South African kind of issues that, you know, as I'm in high school, that I don't know that I would have been aware of, except I was really aware of the music. And so I followed kind of that path into becoming kind of aware and reading a lot, eventually doing actually writing a paper on this period when I was in college, following the music and looking at what was happening with Nelson Mandela. This song that's on the playlist was on heavy rotation in 1984 on MTV. And that it opened a world for me personally to looking at South African artists, including Johnny Clegg, and then that moving into like other South African artists that were kind of doing world music, or what I think we began calling world music. But these also had a direct influence on albums that came out in 1987, Peter Gabriel, So, and then which served to open new audiences for, and not just new audiences, but an idea that the protest, you have to look into why someone is protesting. So the music, I think, for me and a lot of people in the 90s, created a different worldview, that maybe we should be paying more attention to geopolitics, what we do in how our foreign policy affects others, and how maybe the advocating for foreign policy changes is a worthy political goal. So that has effects across the world, and we're going to see that in kind of other forms of music and as well, which is, I know that you talked about working with Jesse Norman, but you kind of have a real strong feeling of also what happens there in the late 80s, what she brings to the table in a massive change.
Mm. Yes. I mean, just to think about it, I was in high school and it just stopped me. There are moments in not just music, but in culture that, you know, in the culture writ large, if you will, that stops you in your tracks. In 1989, and I had to write a little bit of this down because Jesse was a dear friend of mine and creative collaborator, so it's going to keep me on point for Miss Norman's story. In honor of the 200th anniversary of the French Revolution, Miss Jesse Norman was invited by the French government to sing the French national anthem, La Marseillaise in Paris, at La Place de la Concorde. Her performance was part of a spectacular celebration that was the brainchild of French designer and photographer Jean-Paul Goud. The celebration included a nocturnal parade down the Champs-Élysées. Miss Jesse Norman's costume, which represented France's flag, Le Tricolore, was designed by none other than Tunisian-born fashion designer Azzedine Allais. Not bad for a very beautiful, humble, and tremendously gifted young woman from Augusta, Georgia. Think of it, a Black female artist born and raised in the deeply segregated South. Expectations for her were low, as was and continues to be for BIPOC women. And that she chose opera, a courageous and, I would say, in some people's minds, defiant act. And she rose to this incredibly historic occasion, proclaiming freedom at La Place de la Concorde, where Napoleon was a long time ago. This was 1989. The same year as the uprisings in Beijing, at Tiananmen Square. And I heard, and I think from Jesse, that young Chinese students, safely embraced by the French people, rode by on their, bicycles to welcome Miss Norman, to smooth her pathway, and as a way of expressing joy and gratitude as she met many moments in this one. Millions tuned in. If you look at YouTube, you can see just millions tuned in. President Bush Sr. then and Mrs. Bush were there to witness. This was a very, very big moment for African Americans and even further Americans and world citizens. So, yeah.
we don't have this song on the playlist, but we have it up right here. We're gonna and have an opportunity to listen to a little bit. So here we have like a real showcase of an artist and a talent on an international stage using a platform. And, this brings us kind of to the question, I think, that where where we're going to talk about, like, what is the role of art versus artist? In today's culture, we participate in the music of protest. There is new protest music being made. We've looked at songs that we know today because they are number four on the list of greatest songs, the Blowing in the Wind, I think is number 14 on the 500 greatest songs ever written. But we're still producing this work today. We're still producing stuff born out of the same process, which is I see something going on. I see a riot. I'm a witness to this. And I use my art to maybe make a statement about it, or maybe because I'm an artist, that is, it's just because of what I experience in my life is what comes out as art. What's our responsibility? Like, how do we, as a listener, what is our responsibility to that art? What is our responsibility to the artist? What is the artist's responsibility to us?
Yeah, so this is a really good question and a tough one. Because I think for activists, you're looking for things that will help sustain your activism, that will inspire you, that will move you, that will guide you. And also in many ways provide a vocabulary, a lexicon for you to speak truth to power. And oftentimes music helps do that. And then sometimes the artists themselves are moved by a moment. And in these ways, they reflect a historical moment. And then the music helps guide future moments in many ways too. So it sounds like Marvin Gaye's What's Going On could have been written yesterday. And so many of these other songs that we've played that I think have, you know, they contain this timelessness to them because of the ways in which history operates and people operate in history and history in them, in the sense that if we intend to, sometimes we have to make history in order for history to happen. We're looking for cues from artists who have this platform, who have a microphone, and can send their message worldwide, especially today, where you have all kinds of social media platforms that can send the music out instantaneously, right? That might not have been available 30, 40, 50 years ago, or as Adina pointed out, centuries ago, right? So now if we're in this current moment where I think, you know, steadfast activism is necessary, if not required, we see a lot of artists waking up to who again are on the sliding scale. So you might, in the beginning of your career, you might not have been as political, but this moment has made you political. Your fans are political. They're charged and they're looking for something that responds to that. And so this goes back to my point about the tug of war between artists and fans, but also a relationship between artists and fans. We have this deep investment in artists because we're looking for guides in many ways. And then in other ways too, we're looking for them to reflect the movements that we're already making. We've seen a number of instances where artists get involved literally on the front lines where they're marching too. And then in some cases where artists are less in the forefront, but maybe making negotiations behind scenes. They may be making donations behind scenes. And so that's significant too. And hopefully there's a song out there or message out there that they can use their music to invoke that spurs and invigorates that movement to continue.
One of the, you know, we talk about Marvin Gaye and that song is pivotal. It's pivotal to the playlist because it really comes right in the middle, and it's pivotal because it's the popularity of the song will transcend, I think, even what Marvin Gaye had hoped to achieve with it. But at the same time, he then will go on to produce. He doesn't produce another protest album like that. He produces, you know, really, again, popular, I don't know, love songs, maybe, if you want to talk about that, maybe beyond kind of a love song.
So Marvin Gaye is a good example of someone, an artist who would move from what's going on to let's get it on. Right. And he had the range, the breadth as an artist to do that kind of work. And again, as I mentioned before, this has consequences. So you may lose fans, you may gain new ones. And it's oftentimes the case, too, that artists have to make a decision between, you know, the music and their bread and butter. And sometimes the two can't be reconciled. And so this is a struggle for the artists themselves if they're going to make this, take this leap of faith into the political realm. That could cost them gigs. That could cost them a degree of respect, reputation, so on and so forth. At the same time that it might gain them new followers. So, I mean, we see this today where you have, if we look through the 80s on up to today, where hip hop becomes one of those genres of protest music, especially from Black artists. While on one side you have party music, on the other hand, you have artists like one of the songs that's featured on our playlist by Public Enemy, who was decidedly and explicitly political. When rap artists have taken that turn, sometimes it has drawn the ire of the federal government. And this is, you know, follows Black artists especially. There are new movies out that speak to this. Billie Holiday versus the United States is one good example that illustrates, you know, in a fictional way, but illustrates some of the historical, the point that I'm making historically, that this is the power of music, that it's enough to challenge the state, right? That a federal government, or let's say, as we were talking about apartheid, that governments react and they seek to shut down the artist. And again, we're just talking about music, right? We're just talking about some chords. We're just talking about some instruments, a melody. But no, we're not. We're talking about the power that music has and the platform that artists can assume, that they have this thing, this talent, this microphone that can go in multiple directions across the world. And that's unlike an activist who may or may not find themselves being able to penetrate the mainstream political discourse, but this song will, right?
Adina, we started somewhere, right, with jazz, looking at John Coltrane, and we're moving into a period where we also see this similar kind of thing happen in the career of Wynton Marsalis, who you've worked with and kind of know the arc of that career well. And he's on the list because, again, I think that what you see in that music is this arc from Miles Davis to John Coltrane to Wynton Marsalis that really shows a consistency in the messaging of even music without lyrics. Would you agree with that?
Yes, definitely. And I also think that Wynton, in many ways, you know, kind of took up the banner where Miles left off, right? And I mean, even though I'm old enough to remember, was it 1986, when they kind of had a battle of the trumpeters, if you will, between Miles and Wynton at the Vancouver Jazz Fest. But remember, both of them took on the Academy. They were both at Juilliard, right? For a moment in time. And Wynton was playing, you know, Broadway shows, and then got pulled into, similarly, Miles was pulled into, you know, the incredible sound and fury in many ways of hard bop. Well, Wynton really was drawn to Art Blakey. And so he also had this moment, you know, do I, you know, keep this eye on a classical career, you know, which in some ways could be very comfortable for me, or do I go with my heart and be a little defiant and, you know, kind of go for it? And as we know, here we are many years ago, you know, many years later, like Miles, he went for it. And they did have a reconciliation, I've heard, through the years. And but if you look to Wynton from the 80s, you know, what happened with, you know, Miles and him and all of that, sometimes that becomes a defining image for writers and critics of Wynton's whole career, which is, you know, and why is that, right? And then, you know, critiquing him continuously for decades, you know, he's often heralded as the most powerful man in jazz. But then at the same time, you know, there's always this recalling of that original sin of his youth, kind of as a guaranteed way of taking aim. But maybe it's more than the music, right? The only artist to pull off the double whammy Grammy feat, both in, you know, jazz and classical. And he, you know, he did that twice, right? 1983 and 1984. And the sole jazz musician to win a Pulitzer. And I would even go broader than that, you know, outside of the Eurocentric traditions. And I was at the Pulitzer Prize award ceremony to support him and the jazz community in 1997. And Wynton was very humble in this historic moment. And really his whole speech was about giving credit to Duke Ellington, who was initially to receive this great Pulitzer honor back in 1965. So here we go back to the 60s. And ultimately and finally, Duke Ellington was awarded, you know, the Pulitzer posthumously in 1999. So just think, Wynton, the son of a great jazz pianist and educator and a beautifully racially storied Crescent City, New Orleans, wins the Pulitzer, an award typically bestowed upon Eurocentric composers, commissioned by none other than Lincoln Center, you know, for a new work, Blood on the Fields, a 2.5-hour jazz oratorio, a masterwork that delves into the history of slavery and its aftermath in the U.S. through, you know, this kind of epic story and hard-worn lenses of two slaves, Jesse and Leona, as they traverse this difficult journey, you know, to freedom. So is that protest? I'll let our audience decide, but I would guide our distinguished guests here tonight to check out Where Y'all At, the last track off Wynton Marcellus's 2007 studio album, 2 years after Katrina, you know, from the album From the Plantation to the Penitentiary, where he personally raps. He delivers a spoken word tirade against everything from the demise of socially conscious hip hop and misguided politicians to America's commercial and capitalist culture. He asks all you 60s radicals and world beaters, righteous revolutionaries, Camus readers, liberal students, equal rights pleaders, what's going on now that y'all are the leaders? So, yeah.
We were right at our time here. I want to thank both of you for joining conversation with us. I'm gonna close with a story here, really for Dweston in a way. I wanted something I would have told him the other day, but I chose to wait. But I want to thank everyone who joined us tonight. Really, the want to thank the staff that puts on the Bethel Woods at Home. I want to thank Laura, who has been behind the scenes here, kind of running this. I want to thank the great music that we've had. I hope that everyone who's listening will listen to the playlist. It's put together with an arc that I feel is an easy to listen to, but has an important story behind it. I also want to invite you to join us for the next Curator Happy Hour, which is on Thursday, April 15th. As Assistant Curator Julia Fell and myself will share highlights, some of the 1960s fashion from our special exhibition, which opens April 3rd, Lights, Color, Fashion, and Music. You can register for this free program. Visit the website, BethelWoodsCenter.org. We're going to close out here with Childish Gambino's song, This Is America. And I'm going to tell you why, because as we talked about Marvin Gaye, and I kind of looked more into some of the things you had said earlier to Weston about Marvin Gaye, and kind of looking at this arc of writing one of the, not even writing, but producing every aspect of this, what was one of the greatest protest albums of all time, that over COVID, my son has been binging Community, every episode of Community seasons. He's done that twice. And so Community has just been running in the house over and over and over and over. And what you'll, from that, Donald Glover is this amazing comedic actor who just comes off as kind of, in a way, silly, but just lighthearted, and leaves that show to pursue more music. And in 2018, we'll write what I think will become one of the best protest songs ever written. This song has a message that is undeniably powerful. And it's produced in a way, this is what makes me think of Marvin Gaye, that is so interesting. So the first, this starts with kind of this almost a lighthearted gospel feel, or a world music feel that's very light. And we, 50 seconds into that, it just jumps into a really powerful kind of dirge of protest. And this is just, I think this will, in 50 years from now, I think we'll be talking about this as one of the 500 greatest songs ever written. And I want to thank you guys for coming. We'll kind of close out with this. And this has been great. I hope we can do this again. You guys, this has really been great. Thanks very much.
Slipping up, look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Don't catch you slipping up. Look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Look how I'm living up. Police be tripping up. Yeah, this is America. Guns in my area. I got the strap. I gotta carry 'em. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go into this. Yeah, yeah, this is gorilla. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go get the bag. Yeah, yeah, or I'ma get the pad. Yeah, yeah, I'm so cold like, yeah.
Yeah,
I'm so dull like, yeah.
Woo.
We gon' blow like, yeah.
Yeah.
Slipping up. Look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Don't catch you slipping up. Look what I'm whipping up. Look how I'm kicking up.